That's how you change the world.
Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Summerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, with today's message, here's Pastor Vic.
Let's pray. Father, we are in awe of your majesty and your goodness, your glory. And we celebrate you today, God. We celebrate you every day, but especially today, God, we honor you as that ultimate perfect Father. We're thankful, as we read in our psalm this morning, that you are a protective Father, that you watch over your people, Lord, your children. And we're thankful, Lord, that there is nothing, there's no wrong that's ever going to be perpetrated against us, that you won't eventually come and make right. Thankful, Lord, for your court, for your justice. And so, Lord, help us to walk in ways that bring you glory and honor as your children. Help us to know your word, to learn your word, to understand your word, and more importantly, Lord, to walk out your word. And as we open up your word this morning, as we study, God, I pray that you would speak mightily to us. I pray that your Holy Spirit would fall upon this place. And I pray, God, that we would be moved today out of places of comfort, that we would be shaken out of any place, Lord, that is not of you, that we'd be changed by your word. And so we offer this time to you, God. We ask for your blessing, your anointing, and your presence to be with us. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Let's all turn together in our Bibles to John chapter 6 as we continue our journey through the word of God. John chapter 6. Last time, you remember how Jesus had healed a man on the Sabbath, because as he said, God the Father works on the Sabbath, and therefore so does God the Son. Jesus then went on to explain how the Father had given him the authority to judge all of mankind, and he said that he, Jesus, is to be honored just as the Father is honored. In other words, he made himself equal with God. And now, as we begin in chapter 6, John moves us ahead to the third year in Jesus' ministry. And we're going to see that there is another Passover that is near. It'll be the third Passover since Jesus began his ministry. But chapter 6 begins with Jesus back up in the region of Galilee, and it gives us the account of the feeding of the 5,000. And so let's jump in. Verse 1, after these things, Jesus went over the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Again, John has jumped way ahead of what we just covered last week in chapter 5. This is probably a year or so after the healing at the Pool of Bethesda. Remember, John's gospel, unlike Matthew, Mark, and Luke, John's gospel is not a synoptic gospel. John's gospel is a highlight reel, if you will, where John writes in general terms about 22 specific days in the life and ministry of Jesus. And even in those 22 days, he doesn't go into great detail a lot, which is why we rely on all of the other gospels to come along and sort of fill in the gaps. For instance, Matthew's gospel, we see here that Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. Matthew's gospel tells us that the reason Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee is one, he had just learned that John the Baptist had been beheaded, and so he wanted to go off to himself, wanted some alone time to go off and to pray away from the throngs of the people. What also had happened simultaneously at this time, according to the Gospel of Luke and Mark, is Jesus had just sent out his 12 disciples to go and to preach repentance in the surrounding region, and Jesus had given them the power to cast out demons, the power to heal the sick, and they had just returned from that mission. And as you can imagine, they were excited to come and to share with Jesus all that they had done, but they couldn't because, again, Jesus was being bombarded by all of these people. And so Jesus goes off to himself. He takes the disciples with him. They head off to the other side of the Sea of Galilee to go off in isolation. But we're told, verse 2, then a great multitude followed him. And he tells us why. Because they saw his signs which he performed on those who were diseased. So Jesus tries to retreat from the crowd, but the crowd wouldn't let him. They followed him. And then what did Jesus do in response? Did he send them away? Did he rebuke them? Like, can you guys just give me 1 hour to myself? That's not what he did. Mark tells us in Mark 6:34, and Jesus, when he came out, saw a great multitude and was moved with compassion for them. Why? Because they were like sheep not having a shepherd. And so he began to teach them many things. Matthew's gospel tells us that Jesus healed all of their sick. And so Jesus tries to get away. The crowd just follows him. When Jesus sees the crowd coming, what does he do? He spends the whole day teaching and healing. Now, by the time we get to the end of this chapter, it's a long chapter, we're not going to get there today. By the time we get to the end of this chapter, Jesus is going to give one of the strongest rebukes in all of the Gospels, because he's going to recognize that most of these people that are coming after him, that are following him, they're coming not because they're putting their trust in the message that Jesus has brought into the world. A lot of these people, we're going to see the foundation of their faith. The reason that they're following Jesus is solely based on what's in it for them physically. Solely based on the miracles that Jesus is performing for them. And as we saw last week, the miracles that Jesus performed, he himself pointed out, was and is a key piece of evidence. It's his miracles give testimony to the fact that he is sent from God. But signs and wonders, the miracles of Jesus, can never be the basis or the foundation of our faith for two reasons. One, you hear me talking about all the time how signs and wonders can never be the basis of our faith because the devil can do signs and wonders and does. And then, as you know, he can disguise himself very well, even as an angel of light. And he's very good at making us think this is from the Lord, some miracle or sign or whatever. But also, the miracles of Jesus can never be the basis or the foundation of our faith, because sometimes God does miracles in our lives and sometimes he doesn't, right? Sometimes we pray to be healed, right? And sometimes God heals, sometimes he doesn't. Sometimes God miraculously delivers us from persecution or inconvenient circumstances in our lives, and sometimes he doesn't. All based upon what he knows is going to lead to our best outcome, our spiritual well-being. So if my faith lives and dies with supernatural happenings and workings in my life, then it's soon going to die. The minute God decides not to heal me or not to deliver me from whatever situation or circumstance, the minute God doesn't do something the way I think he should, well, then I start to question first whether God's really listening or whether he really cares, or at worst, whether he's even real at all. Now, don't get me wrong, God's still in the healing and miracle-working business, but the how and the when and the why he chooses to do those things or not is far beyond our understanding. And so our faith cannot be based upon miracles or God moving according to my expectations and demands. There's a movement that is very popular among Christian circles today. Some of you may have come out of that movement. It's called the Word of Faith movement. And the Word of Faith movement, it makes God submissive to whatever it is that I demand of him by faith. I can be healthy, I can be rich, I can have anything and everything I want if I just speak it and then believe with enough faith that it's going to happen. But ultimately, as some of you can testify, the Word of Faith movement, it doesn't build faith, it destroys faith. Or at best, it makes your faith a roller coaster ride where you're up, you're down, you're up, you're down, all based on what has God done for me lately. And whether or not God, you know, has been jumping through all of the supernatural hoops that I've laid out there before him. The word of faith movement will make you carnal. It'll make you all about this life. It'll make you like most of these people here in John chapter 6, where your interest in Jesus is only a materialistic endeavor. And ultimately, you think about it, if God is subjected to my every whim, if God is obligated to fulfill whatever I ask of him by faith, then doesn't that make me in charge of the universe? Doesn't that make me God? And thus, doesn't that make me not a Christian, but a heretic? It's important for us to know that we are saved by faith. Faith is vital, but it's equally important. It's equally important for us to know what must be the object and the substance of that faith. Okay? So it's putting my faith in Jesus saves me. Period. Putting my faith in anything else destroys me. And listen, even putting my faith in faith. Make sense? Which is what the Word of Faith movement champions. You put your faith in faith. And as I said, Jesus is going to teach this crowd of people. He's going to heal them. He's going to feed them. He's going to perform miracles right in front of their very eyes. But then he's going to rebuke very harshly those who follow him solely based on those miracles or what they can get out of Jesus physically and monetarily. So Jesus is going to rebuke the Word of Faith movement right here in John chapter 6. And if the Word of Faith churches would just stop teaching people that faith is the instrument that facilitates you and I being able to boss God around, and if they would just dare to teach the Word of God verse by verse in its proper context, then they would soon learn that it's faith in Jesus that saves. It's faith in Jesus that provides the joy and the contentment that everyone is looking for, not faith in faith. Now, verse 3, Jesus went up on the mountain, talking about that steep terrain there east of the Sea of Galilee, known today as the Golan Heights. Jesus went up the mountain, and there he sat with his disciples, again trying to retreat from the crowd, but as we're going to see, the people again won't let him go off to himself. And John's gospel is the only gospel that tells us when this event transpired, the feeding of the 5,000, and why. He says, now the Passover, a feast of the Jews, was near, meaning it's springtime. But then also, all of these people who are present, what he's saying is most of them are probably on their way to Jerusalem. They're all making their, you know, pilgrimage down to Jerusalem in order to celebrate Passover. Now we look at Matthew's gospel to fill in what happens next, Matthew 14:15. It says, when it was evening, his disciples came to him saying, this is not a deserted place, or this is a deserted place, and the hour is already late. Send the multitudes away that they may go into the villages and buy themselves food. So basically, Jesus has been teaching and healing all day. And the disciples come to Jesus and they basically say to Jesus, they're like, listen, church is over. Tell these people, they don't have to go home, but they can't stay here. And raise your hand if Marcus has ever said that to you. But that's not what Jesus does here. Watch, Jesus lifted up his eyes, and seeing a great multitude coming toward him, he said to Philip, who is, by the way, from this area where we're talking about here. This is Bethsaida. And so he says to Philip, who's from Bethsaida, where shall we buy bread that we may eat? Now, if anyone of the disciples knew where to buy bread, it'd be the guy who was from the area. And so Jesus said to him, where shall we buy food that we may eat? But we're told this, he said, to test him. So John wanted to make sure that you and I aren't reading this and we think that, you know, here's Jesus, they're out in the middle of a deserted place. They've got all these people coming toward him. No one has eaten. He's been teaching and healing all day. Everyone's hungry. Everyone's probably hangry at this point in time. And John doesn't want us to think that Jesus, you know, somehow he's drawn a big blank here as to what to do. And now he's reaching out to Philip, you know, basically for advice. Wouldn't that be terrible if you're praying to God about something? I mean, you're just crying out to the Lord and you're on your face and you're just waiting to hear from the Lord because this is colossal, that, you know, just the burden and just all of this on your shoulders, and you just want to hear from the Lord and you're crying out to the Lord, and then the Lord answers you, I'm kind of stumped on that one. What would you do? I am glad the Lord doesn't need my advice or doesn't need my counsel. And so he said this to Philip just to test him. He says, he himself knew what he would do. He already knew what he was going to do, but he's testing Philip. Now we're talking about faith. And Philip is a disciple. He has seen Jesus at this point perform many miracles. But he's one, hopefully like us, he's one whose faith is being built based upon not the miracles, but the message, the words of Jesus, the word of God. He's recognizing now, as he's watching Jesus, he's recognizing that Jesus is the fulfillment of the writings of the Old Testament. He's the fulfillment of the Psalms, of the prophets. He's the fulfillment of the word. And even though many of the multitude of followers are following simply because of what they want physically from Jesus, they want the miracle, in spite of that, Jesus is going to use this miracle as a teaching moment for his disciples. He's going to use it according to what all of Jesus' miracles were intended to produce, which is not a dependency upon the miracles, but a validating of his identity and an authentication of his message, his word. And this feeding of the 5,000, interestingly enough, with the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, this is going to come right before, Jesus is going to feed them right before his teaching that he is the bread of life. So this comes right before that bread of life sermon, that he is going to give his very flesh, his very blood, his very life. He is that bread, and then anyone who eats of that bread, anyone who eats of his flesh will live forever. So this whole feeding of the 5,000 is what sets up that bread of life message, and it puts an imagery in the heads of the people that will make the message easier to understand. Now, when Jesus talks about eating his flesh and drinking his blood and all that, we're not going to get to that today, so I'm not going to get ahead of myself, but other than to say, obviously, he is speaking figuratively and not literally, because this has kind of tossed some people up. But it's metaphoric, it's symbolic language. But still, when Jesus communicates the spiritual meaning behind the miracle of the feeding of the 5,000, when he relates to the people that this isn't about him coming and meeting everyone's physical expectations. This is not about Jesus coming and saving everyone from physical circumstances or supplying even physical bread, even though he's going to do that. When he relates to them that this is all about him saving the world from hell, and this is all about him saving the world from their sins, many in the crowd, most are going to be turned off by that message, so much so that most are going to stop following Jesus at that point. Not all, but many are going to turn away when Jesus explains to them what the meaning of the feeding of the 5,000 really means, what it signifies spiritually. But then you got those who are interested in the spiritual implications and those who are interested in the application and all this, including the disciples, with the exception of Judas. But Jesus uses this as an opportunity to undergird for them what is already a sincere, genuine faith. And so he asked Philip to test him. He says, basically, Philip, listen, there's probably 10, 15,000 people here right now. We know there's 5,000 men. And so you add the women and children, probably close to 15,000 people, if not more. We got 15,000 very hungry people, Philip. Where are we going to buy food? Where are we going to buy enough food for this many people? What are we going to do? And notice Philip, he comes along, he presents another problem to Jesus that in his mind Jesus didn't even consider. Because not only is there nowhere to buy so much food, even if there was, we don't have enough money to buy it. So Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread is not sufficient for them, that every one of them may have a little. Now listen, 200 denarii was about 7 months' wages for an average person. According to ZipRecruiter, this sounds a little high to me, but according to ZipRecruiter, the average monthly salary in America today is a little over $5,700. And so in our vernacular, Philip says to Jesus here, he says, listen, if we had $40,000, it wouldn't be enough to even buy all of these people a Snickers. It wouldn't be enough even for just a little snack. Now, I don't know why Philip didn't just speak a word of faith and command 40 grand from heaven, or why Jesus didn't rebuke him for not having enough faith in faith. Hopefully you're picking up the sarcasm there. But what Philip has done here, he has made his calculations. All right, let's see. We got 15,000 people. Yeah, carry the one. Wait a minute. No matter how much cash we have in the treasury, it's not going to be enough. And what he's done is not too different than what we do most often. Now, he had seen Jesus do many miracles. You've seen Jesus do many miracles, trust me. But what he did is he crunched the numbers, he did the math, and then he proceeded to solve the problem according to his own knowledge and his own strength. And he left Jesus out of the calculation. You ever done that? Am I the only one? And now what Jesus is going to demonstrate for Philip is how he didn't put enough faith in the word. He didn't consider God's track record. He didn't consider what he had seen with his own eyes in the past and what he had experienced. Now, this is how I was thinking about it. This is how Philip should have responded to Jesus' question of, where are we going to get enough food to feed all these people? This is what Jesus was looking for. This is how I would have responded if I were Philip. This is how you would have responded. Vic, where are we going to get enough food for all of these people? Lord, listen, your word tells me that Moses didn't have a way of feeding Israel all the years they were in the wilderness, but they supernaturally got fed every day. Your word tells me that Elijah didn't have any food when he was on the run from Jezebel. Somehow he got fed. It was in our Bible reading yesterday, right? Solomon said in Proverbs 10:3, he said, the Lord will not allow the righteous soul to famish, but he casts away the desires of the wicked. So, Lord, I put my faith in your word. I trust your word because it's true, it's proven, and it doesn't change. And besides, Lord, are you not greater than Moses? Are you not much greater than Elijah? Are you not much greater than Solomon? So I don't know how you're going to feed all these people. I just know that you can and you will. And if you'll just tell me what to do, I'll do it. That's how I would have answered it right there. I have no doubt. That's not how Philip responded. And so that's why Jesus lovingly singled him out to test and to build his faith. And then it revealed to Philip at this point, it revealed, okay, listen, when the rubber met the road and when he was put between a rock and a hard place, his first instinct was to trust in the natural. His first instinct was to trust what he himself could do in the flesh. And I think Philip learned a great lesson in this. Certainly his faith and his trust in the Lord did develop eventually into what God intended it to be. Now, Philip failed this test. We can all agree. You and I are going to fail sometimes. But the key to failure is that you learn from that failure. Any good coach will always say to his team after a loss, he'll say, don't waste this loss. Don't forget how this feels. If any time I'm counseling someone who's repentant and coming out of, you know, a fallen state or whatever, I'll always say to them, don't forget how this feels. How being separated from the Lord. Don't forget about the consequences. Don't waste this failure. Don't waste this loss. It's meant to teach you something, for you to learn from it. Philip would go on to become one of the pillars of the early church, preaching and teaching the gospel and the word of God throughout Samaria and beyond. Philip is the one in Acts chapter 6 that leads the Ethiopian eunuch to the Lord, and he leads him to the Lord by doing just this, by showing the man how to understand and trust in the word. Remember the guy's reading? And Philip's like, do you understand what you're reading there? And the guy says, how can I understand if someone doesn't explain it to me? He gets up in the chariot with him, explains it to him, leads him to Jesus, and they get out of the chariot when they pass by some water, and he baptizes him right there. That's Philip. And now verse 8, another disciple, he's got an idea about how to feed all these people. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, there's a lad here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 small fish. So, okay, listen, just brainstorming here. I saw a little boy. He's got 5 loaves and 2 fish. But then he's like, on second thought, what are they among so many? You know what? Forget I brought it up. That was stupid. That was a dumb idea. Because we need so much. And we've got so little. And now Andrew has done the same thing as Philip. He proceeded to solve the problem according to his own knowledge, his own strength, and his own wisdom, and he left Jesus out of the calculation. When we paid off our land last year, God said to me, very plainly, God said, okay, build. And I was excited. Now I had just made a very large lump sum payment toward the land, you know, to pay it off. And so it left us with only like $17,000 or so in the bank as a church. And I thought, well, listen, if God said build, he must have meant it. And I even said to our staff meeting, I was like, well, maybe what's going to happen is maybe if I go to the bank, the land's going to appraise for a lot more than we paid for it. And maybe the bank, the land is all they'll need for collateral. And so I was excited about it. And Monday morning came and I called the banker. And, you know, We had this conversation about, okay, what do you have for collateral? And I was like, oh, we got, you know, almost 6 acres of land, blah, blah, blah. And he's like, how much cash you have on hand? And I was like, $17,000. He's like, wait, did you say $17,000? I said, yeah. He goes, okay, you're going to need your land for collateral, but you're also going to need $200,000 to $300,000. In cash. And he said, but you know, he goes, I do this kind of thing all the time. It's really very simple. He goes, you just go tell your church, go tell your congregation that you need $300,000. And I responded to that banker with something like, pfft. And I remember hanging up the phone and I was just very dejected. My first thought was, I thought God said build, and I heard it very plainly, but obviously I heard him wrong. But no matter how much I sought the Lord, and no matter how much I prayed to God to reveal to me if he had something different for us, if you want me to wait, if you want me to go in a different direction, if whatever you want our church to do, Lord, you know I just want your will. And so God, if you would just reveal to me what your will was, because obviously we've hit a big wall here. And then God said, build. And I said, but God, we need so much and we've got so little. We got 5 loaves and 2 fish. That's all we got. And I was driving along one day and I had Freedom Radio on. I had a message playing in the background. I don't even remember who was teaching or what the message was even about. But I heard the pastor say one line that really stuck with me and it made a light bulb go on in my head. And that pastor said, a nickel in God's hands is a fortune. And then I started thinking about that $17,000 we've got in the bank. I think that's way more than a nickel. We got a good head start. And then I felt the conviction. I felt the Lord really pressing up on my heart and saying to me, okay, are you ready to go back and make these calculations and finally include me in all this? Or are you just going to keep trying to do this in your own strength? I said, I don't want to do anything in my own strength. I don't want to do anything without you. I want you to do everything. I just want to follow behind you. He goes, all right, then trust me. I said, okay, I trust you. And I kid you not, almost suddenly our bank account started growing. And in no time, it went from $17,000 to $150,000. Mind you, we just paid off $150,000 on the land. So now we got $150,000 in the bank, and I'm starting to get excited. And that's when I brought it to your attention a couple months ago. And I told you back then, you know, we're going to need, you know, I don't know, $150,000 more. We're going to need $300,000 in cash in the bank. And I brought it to your attention. And I can report to you today that we've got 6 acres of land paid for that's worth probably $250,000 down on 61. And we have over $300,000 in the bank sitting there ready to close. I mean, God did it. God did it. Now, you know, a lot's happened in the last couple of months, right? So the enemy's not giving up that easy. And so I won't be surprised, given everything that's happened with the economy and the inflation and gas prices in the last couple of months, I won't be surprised if the bank comes back and says, okay, you're actually going to need a little more. You're going to need this amount or whatever. But whatever the case, I have zero doubt that God is going to provide, God is going to continue to multiply, and we are going to be moving dirt very, very shortly. Now, logistically, we've applied for all of our permitting, including the wetlands delineation, which will take the longest. The mechanical engineering drawings that we've been waiting on just got completed on Friday, which was the last thing we needed in order for the general contractor to then be able to give us a construction estimation cost and then give that to the bank so they can then order the appraisal. So just want you to know, everything is moving along. It's moving like a herd of turtles, but it's moving. So please keep praying. Keep giving over and above your tithe toward the building fund as the Lord leads, as the Holy Spirit prompts you. But I just want you to be encouraged this morning. I am so encouraged by what God is doing in this church. It blows my mind. He just never ceases to amaze me. I'm so honored to be a part of CCS and to have you guys alongside and just what God is doing here. It blows my mind. I want you to be encouraged. I wanted to give you all this information today so that you would know, too, that God has taken our 5 little loaves and our 2 fish, and he has multiplied it supernaturally and miraculously. So be encouraged this morning. Not a whole lot in the world to be encouraged about today, but God is moving. I promise you that. Back to verse 9. So there's a lad that has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. This word that's used for lad in the original language implies that this is a young boy. This is a little boy. And we don't know why he came with a basket of food, but it seems out of all the people that's there, he's the only one that came prepared. Maybe his mother was there. Maybe his mother just sent him with a basket of food, 5 loaves and 2 fish. And when it says 5 loaves, don't think of loaves like Wonder Bread, like we know loaves. These are just actually just little cakes, All right, so he's got five loaves, and then the word for fish indicates that they're very small fish, probably like sardine fish, which was, you know, very, there were a lot of sardine fish in the Sea of Galilee. And so the point is, five loaves and two fish, this is not a lot of food. This is a little boy's lunch, is what it is. But one thing that is worth noting here on the part of this little boy is that we find no reluctance in him as it relates to giving up his food. In fact, everything points to the fact that he gave everything that he had to the Lord, and he did so willingly. Now, God doesn't ask us to give everything that we have, but he does ask us to give beyond what is comfortable, what the Bible calls sacrificial giving. And why does God want us to give sacrificially? Because the Bible tells us that without faith, that is faith in Jesus, not faith in faith, but without faith in Jesus, it is impossible to please God. And giving beyond what is comfortable, sacrificial giving, is a sincere and intense demonstration of faith. What's going on in there? Now, God doesn't need you and I contributing to our building fund, because he's broke and he can't do it without us. God is God and he owns everything. But the fact is, for whatever reason, only God knows, he can do it without us, but he won't do it without us. And it's because he desires to use our sincere and intense giving as a means of growing a sincere and intense faith within us. God says, you give. Not out of the abundance of your wealth. You give out of the abundance of your heart. You give sacrificially, and then you watch the supernatural ways I'm going to use your gift, not just in the church, but also in your life, in your heart, in and through you. Then Jesus said, verse 10, make the people sit down. Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down in number about 5,000 men. And Mark tells us that they sat in groups of 50 and 100. And Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, Mark said that he looked to heaven and gave thanks, communicating to the people that it's God who is the giver of all good things. It's God who supplies all our needs. It's God who multiplies things that might otherwise be insufficient in our lives, which all of these things would serve us well to remember. If God is the supplier of our needs, then We certainly need to have. You know what I meant to say. We need to have hearts of gratitude toward the Lord. I think many Christians spend a lot of time complaining about what they don't have rather than being thankful for what they do have, not realizing that having a thankful, content heart is always what motivates God to give us more, or at the very least, to make what we have go further. Now, God doesn't have to feed us, but he does. And when he does, he deserves to be honored and thanked. And when he had given thanks, he distributed them, the loaves of bread, to the disciples. And then notice, the disciples to those sitting down. It's subtle, but this is important, because what Jesus instructed the disciples to do was to distribute from what he had already given to them. A lot of Christians make the mistake of thinking that when they give, when they tithe, that they are giving to God out of what they produced, out of what is theirs. But the truth is, you and I, we don't produce anything. Everything we have comes from God's, given by God, not for the purpose of you and I becoming independently and utterly wealthy, or to hoard, you know, all that God gives us for ourselves, but God distributes his wealth unto us for the purpose of you and I then distributing it to others. Certainly to the, you know, distributing it to the building of his kingdom. Now again, he doesn't ask for everything. All he asks for is a portion of what he gives to us, the first fruits. And whether it's that 10% mark or whatever, that's between you and God. We're not bound by obligation to give under the covenant of grace. We're not under the law, we're under grace. We give under the covenant of grace according to our love for God and a desire to do our part in building his kingdom. It's that simple. And again, we give as a demonstration of our faith and the fact that I want to demonstrate that God is God over all my life. There's no part of my life that God is not God over, including my finances. And people always want to know, how much should I give? You know, it was so much easier to give, so much easier to understand when they were giving under the law of Moses, because it was just a flat 10%. But how do I know how much to give according to the law of love and the law of grace, when the New Testament doesn't give me any hard line percentage or amount? And the New Testament also implies that the giving, whatever the percentage is to be different for everybody. And that's true. Because under the law of grace, God doesn't want our giving to be obligatory. He doesn't want us to give as some sort of religious gesture. He wants our giving to be according to love. And if you're giving according to love, then that requires sacrifice. That requires sacrificial giving. And the point is that, you know, to some people, giving 10% might be a tremendous sacrifice. To others, maybe not so much. And so that's why it doesn't give us a specific amount. God holds us to a higher accountability related to our giving and everything else under the law of grace than he does under the law of Moses. And so if you want to know a good rule of thumb related to giving under the covenant of grace, if you want to know how much to give, my answer is always this: give till it hurts a little bit. Give until there's a little bit of a sacrifice involved, and you're going to be on the right side of God's heart. So distribute to others, distribute to the building of God's kingdom, a sacrificial portion of what God has given you. That's a great demonstration of sincere faith. So he distributed them, the loaves of bread, to the disciples, and the disciples to those sitting down, and likewise of the fish. And notice it says, as much as they wanted. Man, this is not just a little snack. In fact, everyone ate until they couldn't eat anymore. Everybody is stuffed. God gave them more than they asked for. This is that, you know, Thanksgiving day where you've had two great big plates. You can't even sit down. You know, you got to unbutton that top button, and you got to walk around for a few minutes because you can't sit down because your belly's so full. Yet, there are two pieces of egg custard pie staring right at you that you know you are going to partake in that bad boy. But this is what that is. Everybody is so full because God has blessed beyond expectation. Even the little boy, notice, even the little boy who had given all he had, he received back more than he gave. And God's not going to be indebted to anyone. You are never going to be able to outgive God. So when they were filled, verse 12, he said to the disciples, gather up the fragments that remain so that nothing is lost. Therefore, they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with the fragments of the 5 barley loaves which were left over by those who had eaten. Now the word for baskets, don't think little Easter basket. This is the same word that was used for the basket that lowered the Apostle Paul over the wall when he was escaping from the city of Damascus. So 12 baskets, big enough for a small man to fit in, filled with food that was left over after 15,000 or so people ate until they were stuffed. So this is God doing as God always does, just going over the top with his blessings, doing great signs and wonders that the people would be blessed, but more importantly, that they might believe. Then those men, verse 14, when they had seen the sign that Jesus did, said, this is truly the prophet who has come into the world. So they were well aware of the prophecy given by Moses in Deuteronomy chapter 18, verse 15, where he said to Israel, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from your midst, from your brethren, him you shall hear. In other words, this prophet is the one who's going to have the ultimate authority in the universe. And so you got this crowd of people. Everyone is excited because they recognize rightly that the Messiah has come. The problem is going to be with them is what the Jews expected the Messiah to do when he came. That's where they had gone wrong. You see, they were not seeking a Messiah who would lead them to salvation, who would lead them to eternal life and spiritual freedom over sin. Their hope was very simply in a political king who would come and use his power to overthrow the Roman rule in Palestine. So these people are anxious to be delivered, just not from sin and hell. They're anxious to be delivered from Roman oppression. That's why they're listening to Jesus teach. That's why they're having these big rallies. All these people are coming out by the thousands because they think they're attending a political rally. And seeing Jesus then demonstrate his power, you know, they recognize rightly, okay, this is the one. This is the one that Moses talked about. He has come. And so, as we see here, the people are ready to take Jesus and make him the king of Israel so that he can go and deliver them. He can lead an insurrection and deliver them from the hands of Caesar. But sadly, these people who are ready to hail Jesus as king, they're going to reject him as Savior. They want a king. They don't want a Savior. They don't want anyone to save them from sin and hell. Now, Jesus, in his first coming, his mission was not to overthrow the Roman government or any government. His mission was to overthrow death, to conquer death for you and I, to conquer and pay the consequences for sin. Now, Jesus never, ever got involved in politics in his first coming. His second coming, he's going to get very involved in politics. In his second coming, Jesus will come as that conquering king. He will overthrow all of the government of man. And he's going to be that king that the Jews were looking for at his first coming. But it's going to happen at his second coming. And what happens at the second coming of Jesus couldn't happen until what happened at his first coming. And so that is the very point that the Jews were missing and still miss today. It's important that you and I don't miss the point that John is making in all this. And the point is, as a Christian, you got to wear a cross before you can wear a crown. The victory doesn't come first. The victory is sure, but it comes later. First is the cross. We're going to find that the Jews as a whole were only interested in the crown. A lot of people are interested in the crown. Not a lot of people interested in the cross. They're only interested in Jesus as a political figure. How often we see people today, again, hailing Jesus as king, but we see no fruit in their lives that would indicate that he is their Savior and their Lord. Verse 15, therefore, when Jesus perceived that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, he departed again to the mountain by himself alone. And then we're told, now when evening came, his disciples went down to the sea, got into the boat, and went over the sea toward Capernaum, and it was already dark, and Jesus had not come to them. So Jesus finally goes off to himself, and the disciples didn't want to leave Jesus alone, we know, according to Matthew, but Matthew tells us Jesus made the disciples get in the boat. He's like, no, you're doing this. You get in the boat and you go, I'm staying here. And he goes off to himself to pray. And as we're going to see, the disciples, they're going to find themselves in the midst of this horrendous storm. And I want to point out that they obeyed Jesus. They did what he told them to do. And yet they're going to find themselves in the middle of a very terrifying storm, not because of disobedience, but because of obedience. And doing what Jesus told him to do. So they're in this boat. Some time goes by. They're still rowing. As we're going to see, they rowed all night. They were just getting in the boat when it was about to turn dark. And then this story picks back up the next morning, 6 a.m. in the morning. So they're rowing all night. And they're heading toward Capernaum. And the more time goes by, the more they are concerned about the fact that they left Jesus behind, that he's been all alone all this time. And then it's about to get worse because of what it says in verse 18. Then the sea arose because a great wind was blowing. Now, the Sea of Galilee is normally very tranquil. It's very beautiful and calm, very placid. But it sits in a valley that is surrounded by mountains. And so when the wind starts blowing, it usually blows in from the north, and then it'll kind of swirl around the sea like it does in a football or a baseball stadium or something like that. And the Sea of Galilee, even though it's usually very, very tranquil, it is subject to very sudden, violent, hurricane-like storms that will come up on you without warning, that will just come up on you just like that. And so when they had rowed, it says, verse 19, about 3 to 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and drawing near the boat, and they were afraid. And so they've made their way, they've gotten 3 or 4 miles away from shore. They're heading north into this very strong headwind. Obviously, they're not making any headway at that point because of the wind. Mark lets us know that it's the fourth watch of the night. It's 6 a.m. at this point. And so they're struggling in this storm. Then according to Mark's gospel, they look off in the distance and they see what they think is some kind of ghost or some kind of spirit walking on the water. And it scares the daylights out of them. I mean, they're shaking in their boots right here at this point. But he, Jesus, said to them, "It is I, do not be afraid." Now, at this point, they're still not sure. So this is where Peter, good old Peter, he asked Jesus to verify the fact that it was him. He says, "Lord, verify that it's you by commanding me to walk on the water and come towards you." And then the Lord says, "Okay, come on." And Peter steps out on the water, and then when he does, he just kind of starts getting afraid. The wind's blowing, and he takes his eyes off Jesus. He looks down, and he sinks. And the next thing you know, Jesus is lifting up out of the water and putting him back in the boat. Otherwise, he would have drowned. But he said, "Do not be afraid." And then verse 21, they willingly received him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land where they were going. You know how far out they were? They were far enough where this is obviously a supernatural occurrence, where they're heading in a direction. Yeah, we're trying to get way over there. Jesus steps in the boat. All of a sudden, they're way over there. They're on the shore. Like, whoa. And so, four things that the disciples were freaked out about, and I want to point out, they were worried about the fact that Jesus was alone by himself all night. Second thing, they were worried and concerned that they're rowing into this strong headwind all night, and basically they're not getting anywhere. Like on a treadmill or whatever, and pretty soon you're going to run out of strength. You're just going to be washed out. The third thing they were worried about is the fact that they're obviously out to sea, 3 or 4 miles out to sea. They're in a rowboat. And they're in the middle of a violent storm. I mean, a very violent storm, to where their boat is about to capsize. And if it did, they're all going to die. And then finally, if all of that wasn't scary enough, if that wasn't enough to make you anxious and worrisome and all, they see what they believe to be a ghost. And what's worse is that ghost is heading towards us. Like, he's coming in our direction. And so they're freaked out. But every single fear, every single doubt, every single worry was put to rest in the very instant, the very second that they recognized the voice of the Lord. The very instant that they recognized his face, all is made well. In a moment, in an instant, the wind and the waves were calm. Again, we don't know how far out from Capernaum they were, but as soon as they recognized Jesus, there they are in Capernaum, out of the storm, out of the turbulent seas. They're at their destination. And how true that is for us. When we find ourselves being anxious or being fearful or full of doubt, or we're going through something in our life, it's like, man, this has been going on and on. And I am just not making any headway. I'm in the midst of this storm, and I'm just rowing and rowing and rowing, and I'm not getting anywhere. That's the way it feels a little bit with our building project right now, right? Where we're rowing into a very strong headwind right now. But God reminded me this week, and I think He wants to remind all of us right now, I truly believe that in a couple of years, and maybe less, in a couple of years, we're going to be able to look back on this moment. In John chapter 6, we're going to be able to look back on this moment. We're going to be in a big, new, beautiful building with a louder voice and a greater influence for God's truth in this community. And we're going to be reminded how when we were rowing in what seemed like, you know, into an insurmountable wind, it was the seeking of the face of the Lord. It was taking refuge in His Word, trusting in Him, trusting in His timing, in His sovereignty. It's that that delivered us and brought us through this storm unscathed. The Word of the Lord, the face of the Lord, is man's only answer for the raging seas of life. And those seas are raging out there, if you don't already know. And so look to His face, look to the Word of God. That's where you're going to find your peace, your contentment, the tranquility that we're all desiring. Amen? Father, we are thankful for all that You provide in a human life. Thankful for those stormy seas, Lord, that teach us to trust. Thankful for the headwinds, Lord, that teach us to look to Your face and to draw our strength from the surety of Your Word. Go with us this week. Father, we pray Your blessing upon our lives, upon the fathers here represented today, the families, the marriages, the homes. We ask for Your blessing upon us, Lord. We ask even more so that we would be a blessing unto You and that we would represent Your truth and Your grace in this community in ways that are faithful and in ways that are going to get the attention of this community. They're going to cause people to hunger and thirst for Your truth and to not be moved by materialistic things, to not be moved by even the supernatural ways that You move in our lives, Lord, but moved and solidified, grounded in Your Word and in Your truth. And even so, Lord, we ask that You come for us quickly. In Jesus' name, amen. If you've never accepted the Lord, if you need prayer, available. We'd love to pray with you after service. Next Sunday, we'll pick up right here where we left off in John chapter 6. So be blessed. Let's all stand. I love You, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship You, O my soul. Rejoice, take joy, my King, in what You hear. May it be a sweet, sweet sound in Your ear. God bless you all. Have an awesome week. That's how you
change the world. Thank you for listening to Change the World with Pastor Vic Carroll from Calvary Summerville. It is our hope that this message will help you grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ.